Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Dental CE Academy. My name is Dr. Rowling. I'm the Chief Education Officer here, and I see quite a few familiar names in this attendee list, and I see some new ones, and that is great. We have just such an exciting presentation tonight, and I've had so much fun working with Jen here and Tosha. Before we move forward with the presentation, a little bit of housekeeping. If you look in the chat area, you are going to see brief instructions. There is a link to download the handout and the CE credit instructions, right? The course is 5 to 6 p.m. Pacific time. At 6 to 6:30, we have Tosha and Jen presenting a promotional webinar. And that part, I have to inform you, is not required for CE credit. However, you'll want to stay on because their information is just cutting edge, and you're going to want to learn more about their events in the future. Okay, so again, be sure you have that handout. Download it by tapping on the link in the orange box in your chat area. And I'm going to go ahead now and introduce you to our speakers. And I do want to thank their organization, Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm, for sponsoring this webinar. It's very informative. It will be recorded if you want to listen to it again or share it with your practice. Tosha Kozloski is your dedicated guide at the forefront of advancing hygiene departments. She is a registered dental hygienist specializing in microscopy, salivary diagnostics, and the latest innovative practices. She seamlessly facilitates learning through dynamic virtual training, leveraging the capabilities of Zoom and online training videos. She introduces a fresh and innovative approach to elevate your dental practice. Get ready for a fun and forward-thinking journey toward a healthier dental practice. And Jennifer Seider is a dental hygienist. She is a pioneer in the field of salivary diagnostics and the creator of MicroBlink DX. Her groundbreaking work implementing DNA PCR technology to identify pathogenic activity in periodontal disease has fueled her passion for oral and total body health. She is an expert in advanced dental practices and uses her extensive knowledge and platform to educate teams on the importance of identifying the 11 microbes bacterial test. By using cutting-edge technology, MicroBlink DX can detect bacteria linked to serious diseases such as heart disease, Alzheimer's, diabetes, and preterm birth. Jennifer's mission is to empower clinicians to provide the highest level of care to their patients and bridge the gap between oral and systemic health. So I want to welcome you both here. And following their presentation, they'll be taking about 5 minutes towards the end for Q&A. So please enter those questions in the chat area. Thank you both.
Thank you. I'm so excited. Hey, y'all, welcome to Precision Periodontal Therapy. We're so excited. We've got an action-packed hour for you. And so tuck your kids in bed, grab your glass of wine, relax, and enjoy. Here I am, Jennifer. I'm coming to you from Cookeville, Tennessee. And later here, shortly, you'll hear from Tosha. She's coming to you from Nashville. You won't hear this crazy accent from her because she is from North Dakota. So that may be a good thing. Here's our course agenda. That's in your handout. We're excited to visit with y'all. Learning objectives, of course, those are also in your handout. One of the things that I'm really excited about is Tosha's going to go over the protocols and the coding. I'm just going to get us up to speed and get us calibrated a bit first. One of the things I'm super excited about that Tosha's going to talk about with Precision Periodontal Therapy is she's going to talk about gingivitis. She's got some gingivitis cases and some early perio cases. And we see a lot of those cases sometimes are missed, of course. So what we're excited about is, you know, we want to change what you're doing tomorrow morning if you're sitting behind a patient or Monday morning. We want you to take these tools that you're going to learn in this hour and make a difference. Tosha and I are so passionate about treating periodontal disease. So if you got that patient that you see, and we all have these patients, that you see every 6 months, and they may have some systemic conditions, heart disease, diabetes, maybe even going in for orthopedic surgery, and their gum tissues, they're bleeding, not a lot, but some, and they're red tissues and they have maybe a few pockets. And you just, they're not a prophy, but they're not a full blown perio case. So we're going to be presenting our precision periodontal therapy for those kind of cases tonight. And those are the cases that we can really make a difference in. So those cases that are not necessarily 6 month prophy patients that are not healthy patients. So I'm really excited for that. I mean, those are hard cases. Those are hard to convert and they're hard to code. And so buckle up and get ready because Tosha's got all of the codes for all of that. Copyright protection, of course, we have to have this boots, bugs, and biofilm. We do own all the material. But if you want it, reach out to us. We want to share this information. We would be so excited if you did, actually, because that would mean that you want to do something different. And you'll see this again later, but here is precision periodontal therapy. Here are the codes. Here's the recipe. We want to make these codes, or we have made these codes implementable. So they are ready and actionable. They're ready to go. And they have all the codes, the timing. This is something you can start with tomorrow morning. And that's what I'm extremely passionate about, is making a difference. Okay, so my job here, first off, is to get us calibrated. And I know this sounds crazy, but what is periodontal disease? What is periodontal infections? So one of the things that we were talking about earlier is Tosha. What she does is she implements the hygiene microscope. And one of the things that's really handy with that is when you show a patient this, this, my friends, is periodontal infection disease. This is a bad deal. So when you show a patient this, they usually will tell you, most generally, is that in my mouth? And how do we get those out? And the conversation's over. So versus giving that patient a crash course in dental anatomy that you've just probed and trying to explain pocketing, sometimes this is a good option, just to show them a microscope slide of their infection. Because if there's bleeding gum tissues and pocketing and red hot gums, they're going to grab some bugs. So that's what periodontal disease. It's an infection, too much of a bad bacteria. It all starts with biofilm. So biofilm is that sticky substance that we find on our teeth initially. And I like to use the analogy of, whoops, sorry about that, y'all. I got to play my slide here. I like to use the analogy of a dog bowl. So you know how when you feed your dog over and over and over and you get that ring around the dog bowl, biofilm, when you get that biofilm and then it just keeps packing on thicker and thicker and thicker. So this is a good analogy that folks like to understand. And here's my poor dog and her poor dog bowl. It's clean now, I promise. And when you've got pathogen, when you've got these spirochetes and a lot of systemic bugs running around and you have biofilm, they are going to attach pretty quick. In fact, you know, we used to call biofilm plaque, and we, you know, it's kind of an interchangeable terminology, but plaque is that sticky substance in recent years, and they used to see plaque as biofilm. So the difference between health and periodontal disease is no different than any other infection. So in health, you have non-motile rods. In disease, you saw spirochetes, referring back to that slide we saw. Health, gram-positive, gram-negative. Health, we see aerobic versus anaerobic, and few white blood cells, many white blood cells, and infection. So how fast do oral bacteria grow? They grow very fast, but we are swallowing 100 billion every 24 hours, 100 billion, and they are doubling five times a day. So these bugs, and I'm going to use the word bugs, microbes, pathogen, bacteria, use whatever you want, whatever makes sense to you and whatever you feel comfortable with, you can use anything. So, but they are doubling five times a day. It's a major problem. So why do patients visit the dentist? You know, you don't have patients knock on your door, come on in for an appointment that say, you know, my gums were bleeding this morning when I was brushing. That doesn't happen. At least it doesn't happen in Cookeville, Tennessee. May happen there where y'all are at, but they don't just come in because they think they have gingivitis. That doesn't happen. So we have to do our due diligence, particularly as dental hygienists, in diagnosing and converting these patients and talking to them and educating them. They may be in our chair, they may be in the doctor's chair, they may be an emergency patient. So think about that, is we have to find it. So we have to detect this periodontal infection. But first, we need to determine what is healthy, because if you're not healthy, you're sick. And remember, hygiene does not fix sick. Hygiene is for maintenance therapy. If you look at someone's skin, can you tell if they're healthy? I mean, you have no idea if I'm healthy or not. And when you go in for a physical, what do? They do blood testing. If you have your child that has pustules on your throat, a fever, doesn't feel well, what do? You take them in, they do a strep throat culture, they do flu A, flu B, and now they'll do a COVID test. They do all their diagnostics to really see what's going on. How sick is this child? They want to know. They're doing all the diagnostics. The most common infection in the world is periodontal disease. And it's our disease. As dental hygienists, this is what I'm so passionate about is, as a dental hygienist, we have our own infection that we treat. No other profession has this one infection that they only treat. And if we don't treat it as dental, and I am a dental hygienist, but if we don't treat it as dental hygienist, it's not going to get treated. So we've got to step up and treat this. Periodontal disease is both an infection and a disease. So you can use the word interchangeably. I particularly like to say infection because when you say you have an infection, you get that, you get lights flying around. And periodontal disease is the only disease infection that gets treated the same way, no matter how bad it is, until tonight. So let's do a little anatomy. I know this sounds trivial, but did you know that the mouth is in the skull? So when you have periodontal disease, basically what is happening is the bacteria are eating away at the bone in the skull. You're losing bone in your skull. That sounds crazy, but it's true. So if you had an infection on your toe, say, and it was eating away at the bone, I mean, all the sirens would be going off, all the alarms. Oh my goodness, we got a serious problem. Also, it's with it being in your skull, you're swallowing it, you're inhaling it, you're passing it to person to person. The skull is so, so vascular. It's going through your bloodstream. So think about that. I know we have this void with medical and dental insurance and they're separated, but it is in your body and it is in the skull. So, okay, let's go into some oral systemics. So I'm personally going to give you some of my favorite studies. This may be one of my favorites because it's in the Blood Transfusion magazine. But blood donors with periodontitis are considerably more likely to donate blood contaminated with bacteria. So 48% of blood donors have periodontitis, which doesn't surprise me. Okay, think about this. So if you have got a short sleeve shirt on, you walk in, you're going to donate your blood. I'm O positive. Everybody wants it. So you walk in and I've got this big old infection on my arm because the amount of gum tissue in your mouth is what's on your forearm and it's just skin. If I walk in and I've got this big old ulcerated infection, the nurse is going to be like, yeah, I don't think we want your blood. Like, something's not right here. But if it's in your mouth, they go ahead and take it. So think about that when it comes to, it's kind of crazy. P. gingivalis, which is one of our red pathogens with this bug right here, possesses unique properties to invade the arterial walls to survive intracellularly to escape the immune system. So they're like, oh, we're just going to hang out in here and y'all just cruise on by. I mean, they're just hiding out. These guys are so, so smart. P. gingivalis is so smart and so bad. And periodontal pathogens actually attaching the inside of the ulcerated pocket. So this would be a simulation of an ulcerated pocket. It's ulcerated. It's inflamed. You know how when you have a wound and it's all ulcerated, your mom is like, oh goodness, we cannot get this dirty. We got to put a Band-Aid on it. We got to put something on it. You don't want to get it infected. But here we have an ulcerated pocket. And what the research is finding is not that periodontal disease causes systemic disease. It's the pathogens, it's the bugs, the bacteria that cause periodontal disease that contribute to systemic disease. So it all comes down to the pathogens, the bugs. And individuals with periodontal disease have 1.4 times higher risk of developing coronary artery disease. There are so many studies on linking systemic disease with oral disease. So there's a lot of studies you can find on that. Preterm birth, low birth rate babies, Fusobacterium is what we're concerned about here, which is this pathogen right here. They have found the presence of Fusobacterium in the lungs and stomach of a stillborn baby. And what I do like about this article, it was in an OBGYN. So it's a pretty serious article here. This is an oldie but a goodie. So you know, have those patients that say, oh, I'm going to go in and have a surgery. 6-8 hour procedure and they're going to intubate the patient, what they're finding is that the oral bacteria can actually jump on the tube, making their way to the lungs, which of course increases pneumonia. So if you have a patient that may be going in for a surgery, you could tell them, hey, you know, let's do some extra testing. Let's do some extra checking just to make sure you don't have any bad bugs in your mouth that could cause some problems during the surgery. Okay, so then in some of the protocols, Tosha is going to present our bacterial test, the microblink bacterial test. So I just want to get you up to speed on that. Here's what a report would look like. And I hope you all can see my mouse. And then this is the types of bacteria. So we've got our scaling and root planing resistant, our tissue invasive, and our intermediate bugs. So just to give you an idea of really what bugs are the bad bugs and what to be concerned about. And just remember, you know, we know there's 500 to 700 different types of bacteria in the mouth, and these 11 are the ones we're concerned about when it comes to periodontal disease. And to wrap up my part, this is a one of my colleagues and my daughter, Kennedy. She's 12, and so this kind of hit home to me, but they sent this in. This is a 12-year-old girl, and she said, wow, have you seen this? And we do. We see, you know, we have pedo offices and we do see infections, but not like this. We don't see this red complex this high very often. And I'm like, how did this little gal get this? Can we test who she lives with? Well, she lives with her grandmother. Here's the grandmother's report. And here's the grandpa. So we definitely know periodontal disease. We've, of course, always known periodontal disease is contagious. But when you are running through our precision periodontal protocols and you decide to follow up with those, also think about that. So when you have that patient that you're taking through therapy, you know, say, hey, treat this like strep throat. Change out your toothbrush. Don't be running around drinking after everybody. We shouldn't anyways, but treat this like an infection. It's an infection. So I will tap out here. Let's see if I can. And I'm going to hand the mic over to Tosha. Hey, girl.
Well, hi, everyone. Let's get right into what precision periodontal therapy is. So what is precision periodontal therapy? Well, it is grounded in the 4P medicine model. And that term was actually coined by Dr. Leroy Hood. And the 4Ps stand for predictive, preventative, personalized, and participatory, all with the goal of early intervention and prevention that uses personalized care to reverse and restore disease. So defining these pillars a little bit further, the first pillar is preventative. So that's where we're looking at our patient's medical history, any potential red flags, their lifestyle factors or choices, their overall periodontal history, and newer to the game is that biofilm risk assessment. The second pillar is preventative. So alerting our patients to any potential risk factor that they have so that they can make proactive shifts in their life, using screening tools like biofilm sampling, salivary diagnostics, oral cancer and blood pressure screenings, all are very preventative. So that in that way, we can be way more proactive about the care that we provide. The third pillar is personalized. So based on all of our findings from those first two pillars, we can make adjustments as needed. Fourth, participatory. So we can only guide our patients to these successful plans that we make with them, but they have to be the one to do it. So when Jen and I were thinking about the type of periodontal therapy protocols that we wanted to put together, we really wanted to create a recipe for consistency. And so for me personally, what comes to mind when I think about a recipe is I have consistent ingredients that are always going to give me the same result every single time. So I thought about around the holiday season, I love to make my family's sugar cookie recipe. Now, these things are like melt in your mouth delicious, the kind of sugar cookie that, well, you could put frosting on it, it's good in and of itself. And so that's what I was kind of thinking about when we were thinking about precision periodontal therapy and the exact ingredients that you guys can use to put those together to give you more consistent results. So these ingredients that we need in cookies or in any type of baked goods is we need our wet ingredients, our dry ingredients, and then we need a specific baking time. And just like with any ingredients, if we sub out almond flour for wheat flour, it's probably not going to taste exactly the same. If I forgot to take my butter out of the freezer and I stuck it in the microwave versus soften it, my cookies don't bake quite right. So while they can still turn out, I may have less than perfect, a less than perfect cookie at the very end. So the dry ingredients that we're going to talk about with precision periodontal therapy is using a comprehensive perio exam, using photography as much as humanly possible, full set of x-rays, microscope slide, and salivary diagnostics. So when it comes to the wet ingredients, I felt like this was really appropriate since when we're doing gingivitis and SRP, it does get a little bit of bleedy wet in there. So gingivitis therapy 4346, the SRP codes, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about the 4921 shortly. When it comes to home care, every single patient needs some solid home care instructions. And we now understand that brushing and flossing for patients that have a periodontal infection, brushing and flossing is typically not enough because brushing and flossing doesn't do a solid job of penetrating that biofilm wall. And we'll talk more about that shortly. So everyone has to ask, but what about the frosting, Tosha? What's a Christmas sugar cookie without frosting? And I couldn't agree more. I love frosting. I love thick frosting, especially on my sugar cookies. It just makes them better. There's a reason they say it's the icing on the cake, right? So when we think about our laser protocols, ozone therapy, prebiotics, probiotics, this list is extensive. That is really where the frosting comes in. So tonight we're going to be focused on baking the perfect cookie. So having a periodontal therapy that you can follow the recipe to successful results. Now that doesn't mean that frosting isn't a great option as well, but we wanted you guys to be able to just insert those frosting pieces wherever you want to, depending on your particular practices, modalities, and what you have to offer. Now, the codes that I'm going to be talking about tonight are not mine. They're not Jennifer's. We got them straight from the ADA CDT. We're to the best of our ability, reading right through the book, exactly verbatim what the descriptions and the nomenclature says. So if you guys have any further questions on any of these codes, these are live links here. So in your PDF, you can investigate them further. I recommend every year just getting the updated copy because there are some changes that can happen. And it just keeps you apprised on the different things that you can do with these codes. So staging and grading. So in 2018, staging and grading was developed, and that was to help us more specifically identify the current disease state of each individual patient. Now, the classification system wasn't bad necessarily, but they didn't feel like it was specific enough to each patient. So we know that when it comes to staging and grading, we're taking that patient's medical history into account, as well as their probe charts, their clinical attachment loss, all the things. Now, when it comes to code selection, I like to tell my clients we have a lot more stages and grades than we do codes. So when we're considering what code to use, it has more to do with radiographic bone loss and then supplementing that radiographic bone loss with your clinical signs and symptoms. So not your pocket depths necessarily. So the codes that we're going to be mostly talking about tonight in terms of the therapy portion are wet ingredients, is the 4346, which is your gingivitis code. And then of course our SRP codes 4341 and 4342. Now this is super important. When we're considering code selection, it's all about radiographic bone loss. So we wanna look at that crestal height compared to the CEJ. What this means in a nutshell is that if you don't have radiographic bone loss, you don't have root exposure to do scaling and root planing. So let's look at this. So on this bite wing NPA, the black arrow is showing you that crestal bone. The red arrow is showing you right around where that CEJ is. Now, the normal distance from the CEJ is 1 to 1.5 millimeters. So if you have bone, the space between there is going to determine how much radiographic bone loss you had. And so we always need to also make sure that you're clearing your contacts, because if you don't clear your contacts, we can't see the alveolar crest or we can't see the CEJ. So some of our patients, of course, they have, you know, tilted or tipped or crooked teeth, and it can be really hard to clear those contacts. My suggestion is to retake x-rays and PAs to best attempt to clear those contacts. Or we're going to face denials, slowed down claims, and all kinds of things. So a common reason for getting our claims denied is for lack of evidence. That's the primary reason that things get denied. We have narratives we have to write, all those different really exciting, fun hiccups that happen. Now, a lot of the times, it's not that we don't have the proper data. It's that we may not have submitted it correctly to the insurance payers in order to gain reimbursement. So going back to these bite wing x-rays, it's super important that we can see the CEJ and the crestal ridge. If you have a cone cut or your contrast is way off, it's hard to determine where that CEJ and that crestal ridge is. And again, if we didn't clear our contacts, even if you have radiographic bone loss, like on this third bite wing there, it's going to be really difficult to see. It's right now, there's most primarily our claims are being looked at by artificial intelligence algorithms. So what that means is if the algorithm can't read your claim, it's going to be slowed down and potentially not paid. So that doesn't mean we can't refile the claim and all that good stuff, but that takes a lot of time. It's a bit of a hassle, and it's not always clear what information we were missing. So my attempt here is to just show you what to file in what sequence to help get those claims processed much more quickly. So pano and four bite wings are what some offices try to use to get SRP reimbursement. Now, it's not that it's impossible to get reimbursement utilizing a pano and four bite wings. It's just not a safe way to do it. So I recommend an FMX whenever possible, because with a pano, unless the patient is like class three, you're really not going to see where that bone is. I mean, we're taking a three-dimensional object and flattening it out. So really can't see very well. So if I was going to submit this particular pano with these bite wings, as you guys can see, my bite wings don't show radiographic bone loss very well. So the chances of this claim going through without a problem is pretty low. The next thing is our perio charts. We really need to make sure that our perio charts are completely complete. And with that, I mean, not just probe depths, but including your clinical attachment loss, including all of your recession, your bleeding points, all the things. And when we're filing SRP claims, that perio chart needs to be within 12 months of SRP. If you forgot to finish it, or there was a couple teeth that you just ran out of time and you try to file it later, it's too late. We can't do it. You're not going to get payment. So we definitely need to make sure that that is completed in its entirety prior to that SRP claim being submitted. Another reason, again, more lack of evidence. And this could be that a date is missing, that maybe a part of a narrative didn't get added to the insurance claim, but it's in the clinical notes. So when we're cutting and pasting, it can be easy to accidentally cut off a date. Well, that could be a reason to slow down that claim. When it comes to clinical notes, we have to have really definitive items in our clinical notes. So this slide here is everything that you guys need to increase your chances of having your claims flow through much easier. So full perio chart, including clinical attachment loss, bleeding points, all the things within 12 months of an SRP claim. Anytime you can do a full set of x-rays, it's always going to be best. Full set of x-rays are just the optimal thing when it comes to SRP claims. Now, in a time where we have such great technology like cone beams and iTero scanners that show radiographic bone loss so well, unfortunately, it's just not part of the algorithm yet. So the best way to know what x-rays you need for your specific payers that you guys are in or out of network with is during insurance verification. Just ask what do they require when filing those SRP claims. Now, when it comes to photography, the more the better. Every single gingivitis case, 4346, you should have a picture like this in the upper right corner. So something that's kind of bloody like this that really showcases how serious these infections are, that's what you really want to do. So whenever possible, do it. If I'm filing an SRP for the upper right quadrant, I'm definitely going to accompany that with a photo of how serious this infection is from the upper right quadrant. There are times when our perio chart and our x-rays make the infection appear to be not that bad, but a photo can really take it to the next level. So let's file them whenever possible. In our clinical notes, we want to have a clear diagnosis. What is that active periodontal disease grade and stage? What were your clinical findings? And then what is your diagnosis of that patient? What do you want them to do next? All of those details, we don't have too much room when we're utilizing those claims. So we can't have this long drawn out explanation, but there's a few things that we absolutely have to have. And these are some of those. So when we're talking about stages and grades, we're going to be using the AAP's grading and staging system. But we add a PPT zero, and we, as we know, there is not a AAP zero. It just goes 1 to 4. So the way that I like to look at staging and grading is similar to a grim example would be cancer diagnoses. So we know that if cancer is found in stage one, it's at an earlier stage where it hasn't metastasized and done as much damage to the full body as a stage four. And some of you may have even heard of cancer stage zero. So that's like really when we actually would want to catch it at the very earliest stages. So just like gingivitis, before that infection has really metastasized and caused a huge problem, that's when we want to catch it. So PPT zero is your recipe for gingivitis. PPT one is your AAP class one, and that is your recipe for that particular patient. So every time that you guys see PPT on here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, or 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, that is your specific recipe for those particular patients. And again, if you have frosting in your office, then go ahead and add those in to those codes. But we first want to make sure that we have a great recipe to make a consistent cookie every single time. So the next step I'm going to go through with you guys is we're going to go through a few case studies so that I can show you based on that particular patient, what specific codes I used and why. And then after I go through the case study, I'm going to literally go through every appointment with you so that you can see how much time I had and what codes I did. And then I'll explain what I physically did too. So this first case is a 28-year-old female. So she was a new patient to the practice, and her main concern was that she had bleeding gums for as long as she can remember, which is a little bit crazy considering she's only 28 years old. And so she stated that her current dentist and dental hygienist just kept saying that she needed to floss more. That was their main concern. She said that she did the best that she could, but because her gums were so tender that it was really hard for her to do. So as part of the new patient process, we reviewed a full medical dental history. She didn't have any underlying health conditions, full set of x-rays, all the charting, all the probing, full perio charts, intraoral photo series, intraoral extraoral photos, and a biofilm sample. This particular practice did have a phase contrast microscope, so we did that. So let's jump over to her x-rays. So looking at her full set of x-rays, let's be looking at these x-rays from an SRP standpoint. That's all we're worried about here tonight during this CE. So looking at her x-rays, looking more closely at the bite wing, since that's usually the easiest spot for us to really look for radiographic bone loss, she really doesn't have much. I mean, her overall bone levels look really, really good, thankfully. So we could maybe scrutinize and say possibly a little bit of bone loss on number 13, on the mesial there, potentially number 19. But when I compare those bite wings to the PAs, it's really not super obvious. So I'm not thinking that that algorithm is going to count that as radiographic bone loss. So for all intents and purposes, she really doesn't have any radiographic bone loss. This is what her perio chart looks like. So a bit different than what those x-rays look like. And this is where a lot of our patients fall. They have lots of pocketing, lots of inflammation, bleeding, all the positive clinical signs for a gum infection, but they don't have radiographic bone loss yet. So in this situation, we always have to go back and look at the x-rays to determine which code are we going to use for this specific infection. Code-wise, she does not have radiographic bone loss. If I were to look at her perio chart and base my code versed on the perio chart, I'd say she needs 4 quads of 4341, but that would not get reimbursed because she doesn't have bone loss, because in order to do scaling and root planing, I need roots to plane. So looking at her biofilm sample. So after I looked at her perio chart and her full set of x-rays, I was pretty sure that she had a gum infection caused by bacteria. So the next step was I took a small plaque sample from her mouth and put underneath the microscope and said, wow, this definitely explains all of the inflammation and the bleeding that you've been having for years. You came in contact with some bad bugs and your mouth got sick. So what we're seeing on this microscope slide is a lot of spirochetes, those little snaky ones, or some rods swimming around in there. We even see a whole bunch of white blood cells here and even an amoeba over here. So this is a very serious, very dysbiotic biofilm. She was super freaked out by her slide, but also she had relief on her face too, because she was like, this is what's been causing all of this inflammation. So she realized it wasn't her fault. She just came in contact with some bad bugs and her mouth got sick. And so now she was looking to me going, oh my gosh, we can fix this. What can you do about it? So it was pretty awesome. So we immediately diagnosed her with generalized gingivitis, which, so her recipe was Precision Periodontal Therapy 0 for gingivitis. These are her clinical signs and symptoms that we've been seeing here. And so gingivitis therapy was the next step on the list. But before I set her free and scheduled her, the next thing that I wanted to do was find out what exact bugs was I seeing on the microscope. So we know certain shapes are not part of our good bacteria, but without a lab test, we don't know exactly what they are. So my next step was, is I just took 5 paper points, put them next to the gum line that just soaked up the dead bugs, and we sent that off to the lab. We found out that she had 8 of the 11 pathogens that we test for, and they were really, really high. Now, remember, she's only 28 years old, so she's got a pretty serious infection. Thankfully, not necrosing the bone yet. So let's recap what I'm going to do at every single appointment. So starting with my dry ingredients, my diagnosis appointment, all of these diagnosis appointments are going to literally look exactly the same to you. So commit them to memory once and you got them. So the first thing I'm going to do is a comprehensive perio exam. Now, this code isn't probably being utilized as much as it could be in most practices, or at least that's my findings anyway. So a comprehensive perio exam is a comprehensive exam plus a full probe chart. And so in the nomenclature, in the description, it says the D-O-1-8-O is showing signs and symptoms of periodontal disease. She was definitely showing signs and symptoms of periodontal disease. She had a full-blown gum infection that we verified with a microscope and with a lab test and her perio chart. The next thing that we wanted to do was photography. I love photography. We should all do lots and lots of photography because a picture is worth 1,000 words, right? The microscope slide. So we don't have a code for the microscope. And so we just have to create an internal code for tracking purposes. I strongly recommend always creating codes for anything that we do, whether or not we have a code for it, just create one if there's not an ADA code. So then at least we know how often we're utilizing that technology. And it's much easier to track on a ledger view. X-ray. So the reason that I have the X-ray zeroed out for this is because it's a recipe for Precision Periodontal Therapy 0, meaning payers do not require X-rays when you're filing a gingivitis case. So whatever the patient is due for is just fine for this particular one. And then we did the lab test. So I used code D415 for the salivary lab diagnostics. The next thing I was going to do is get her back ASAP for gingivitis therapy. So for this appointment, I scheduled her for 60 minutes and I did a 43-46. Now, something really important here. So hear me now. So 43-46, 43-41, and 43-42 are so much more than what their description is. So this is not just scaling in the presence of inflammation, and scaling and root planing isn't just scaling and root planing. So although that is the terminology we have for those codes, for like what the numbers stand for, but what we understand now is that really what we're wanting to do with our scaling and root planing is we want to disrupt and disorganize the biofilm. These infections are caused by bacteria, and our immune system is just left hanging here. Our immune system's not able to take care of it. And so these infections really cause huge, huge problems. So what we really want to do is disorganize that bacteria, disrupt it enough and decrease it enough so that the immune system takes over. Part of our ADA book states that it's to remove toxins and bacteria. And that's exactly what we want to do. So our focus isn't about the calculus and the plaque. Yes, we have to also get that off, but we really have to focus on is what I'm doing decreasing and disrupting the bacteria. Am I using an ultrasonic device? Yes, you can use hand instruments too, but are you going to use any medicaments? Yes, we should be. So we know like a Cavitron, a piezo, all those kinds of things, there's some kind of liquid running through it. Why not make it an antimicrobial? If you don't have access to that and it's just plumbed into the water lines, get a Monajet syringe, get a Luralox syringe, put an antimicrobial in that. There's all kinds of ways that we can do this. When it comes to the home care, I am a huge fan of every single time we need to show, tell, have the patient do. So in part of that, I consider jumping over to the home care now. The main thing that we want them to do is the same as we're doing in the office, disorganize the biofilm so that it's not flourishing and taking off and continuing to cause this infection. So brushing and flossing, as I mentioned earlier, is just not enough. And so what we understand now when it comes to biofilm is that here, I'll give you a nice little example here. So pretend this is the tooth, and then this is the biofilm. So biofilm has these finger-like projections, and then the biofilm is in that mushroom cloud in the top. So it's living inside there. So basically what's happening is the nutrients are flowing through and it's all having this nice little home. So if we're brushing and flossing, we're just dislodging it and it's just falling off. And if we don't spit it out, it might just attach someplace else. No big deal. What we need to do is penetrate that biofilm wall, because if we don't penetrate that biofilm wall, we're not going to fully get rid of it. So that's where like a water pick or there's several different brands of water flossers out there really helps, because that stuttered stream can penetrate that biofilm wall and disrupt and disorganize the bacteria. Perioprotect trays work slick as well. The peroxide is going to oxidize and that can get through that biofilm wall. There's a lot of really great antimicrobial rinses out there. When it comes to the water pick, pick one that's like a concentrated rinse that the patient, all they have to do is add water to it. And so, you know, so don't just like go to the grocery store and just find something and throw it in your water pick. That's not meant to be used in a water pick. It's meant to swish and gargle typically. And some of them are no good. When it comes to an electric toothbrush, many patients can super benefit from this, but I like to keep it pretty simple with my patients. Show them how to do a solid job brushing their teeth twice a day, disrupt the biofilm at least once a day. And then I send them on their way and I make sure they understand what they're supposed to do. From there, I'm going to get my patient back in about 6 weeks to check everything out. So I'm going to look at the microscope if I have a microscope. If I don't have a microscope, I'm going to be scrutinizing over how much plaque or debris biofilm is in their mouth. I'm going to take new photos because it's super motivating for patients to see my mouth was red, now my mouth is pale pink. And then from there, I elected to use code 4921. If you guys remember her perio chart, she was full of pockets, lots and lots of inflammation, lots of infection. My goal with her therapy is to disrupt and disorganize the biofilm, the bacteria, the pathogens that are causing this infection. And so I wanted to use my ultrasonic to debride any potential plaque, calculus, bacteria that's in there, and then use an antimicrobial at the same time, so that I'm decreasing that overall pathogen load, because my goal is to assist her immune system enough so that then she takes over, she goes back to health. So when I looked at her microscope before and after, this is what it looked like. So she started out with lots of volume, lots of motility, lots of bugs that shouldn't be in any of our mouth. And it decreased down to very few pathogenic bacteria. For the most part, we got rid of almost all of them right away. So she was absolutely making progress in the right direction. So I got her back in 3 months for a prophy because, again, she didn't need scaling and root planing, so she wasn't a perio maintenance. So I got her back for a prophy. My goal at this appointment is to make sure that she's still on track. So she's gotten a longer leash now. She's been gone for 3 months. So when she comes back in, I'm going to do a prophy, make sure everything looks good. I'm going to take another microscope slide if I have a microscope. And then if she's due for an exam, you would do an exam. But I definitely want to do a new salivary lab test because I want to see, was my therapy successful? This has given her immune system enough time to create homeostasis again. And so I want to see like how did everything look? Depending on her home care will depend on what I all need to potentially work on with her there. And this is what she looked like. So before and after photo, she looked amazing. You guys saw her microscope before. That was already on track. That was looking super great. And then her lab test looked great. So she started with 8 of the 11 pathogens and she's down to only 3, and they're at very reasonable numbers. So definitely at this point, I'm like, keep doing what you're doing. It's working. Don't stop. So many patients are tempted to be like, oh, I don't need those trays anymore. Oh, I don't need that water pick anymore. But no, you do. You had an infection. I can never immunize you from it. So just keep doing what you're doing because it's absolutely working. And if you guys notice her photo, her gums aren't just less red at the margins. Her gums are less red in her entire mouth, down to the vestibule, the whole thing. It's absolutely fabulous what happens. Jumping to the next one. Okay, this was a 33-year-old patient. She wasn't new to the practice. She'd been seeing this practice for probably 5 or 6 years. The only thing new to her was that she'd started a clear aligner system in the office about 8 months prior. And so she was due for a full set of x-rays and all the good stuff that we do. And so she wasn't so much aware of the inflammation. I mean, when it was brought to her attention, she was kind of like, I just kind of thought it was normal with the aligners. I'm not too worried about it. So her x-rays are here. So as we can see, she has radiographic bone loss starting in all 4 quadrants. This is a huge red flag to me because when we're moving teeth with orthodontic aligners, we're dissolving and regrowing bone to shift the tooth over. Now, if somebody has a periodontal infection, doesn't matter if it's gingivitis or stage whatever, it's an infection. That's going to inhibit the osteoblast. So it's going to inhibit the amount of bone regrowth that can happen. So when that patient is done with their aligner system or done with their orthodontics, they're going to have these really awesome black triangles that they're going to be super happy with you guys about, right? Not so much. So what we really want to do is make sure that all of our patients are healthy, but especially if they're in orthodontic aligners, we need to warn them like, hey, if we don't get this infection under control and do this in teamwork, then you may end up with these little black pepper spots in between your teeth. So she doesn't have a full quadrant of bone loss. She's got 2 to 3 teeth in each quadrant that has radiographic bone loss. Now I did mention, and I showed you guys her photo, she had lots of inflammation in there. So she has generalized pocketing, bleeding points, the whole thing, recession, all the things already. So serious infection going on here, but she wasn't aware of any of it or that startled right away until she saw her microscope slide. And this made sense to her, like, hey, I came in contact with some bad bugs and my mouth got sick. The thing with these periodontal pathogens is they live inside the gum tissue, not just on top of it, which is why a lot of our patients have super slick home care, but it doesn't take care of the infection. So she was diagnosed with stage 1 localized stage 2 grade B, and her recipe was PPT1. So precision periodontal therapy 1, her clinical findings are here. So 4 quadrants of 43-42 was what we selected for her because she didn't have a whole quadrant of bone loss. Next step, just like that first case, was I wanted to do a lab test. I saw squirmy wormies on the microscope, but without a lab test, we don't know exactly what they are. So she had 6 of the 11 pathogens that we test for. And that first appointment, so exactly the same as the last one, like I'd shared. So her dry ingredients, those are never going to change with any of these cases here. So we're always going to use that comprehensive perio exam because she's showing signs and symptoms of periodontal disease. Intraoral photography, I think we should use it with every single patient, every single appointment if we have time. A microscope, if you've got it, use it every single time. Full set of x-rays, the 210. With SRP cases, it is always best to use a full set of x-rays. There are some insurance payers that require it now within 6 months. So it's just good to get a fresh one. And then of course, our salivary lab test. Got her back ASAP for the 43-42. Now, since we're treating a periodontal infection that we know has lots of bacteria associated with it, and her immune system is not doing a good job keeping it at bay, do you think I'm just going to scale 2 to 3 teeth in each quadrant? Of course not. No way. No way, Jose. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the entire quadrant. And yes, I may have to spend a few more minutes on those teeth that have radiographic bone loss, especially if there happens to be some more calculus and those areas probably need a bit more flushing out. But the bacteria may potentially be slightly higher in those pockets, but it's still in the 2 millimeter pockets. We know all infections start in 1, 2, and 3 millimeter pockets. It doesn't just start when it becomes a 5. So we have to clean everything out. So my goal with SRP has nothing to do with the calculus. If there's calculus there, I'm going to get it out. I'm going to treat that patient like my board's patient. I don't want any of it left. But my main focus is that, again, bacteria disruption, and because I want to decrease that overall pathogen load, because I know that if I can decrease those pathogens, then her immune system is going to do what it's supposed to do. It's going to take over and get her healthy again. My job is just to assist her body in health. So full right side, home care, again, the baking instructions don't change. You're going to make sure that you've got that, have that patient on something that's going to, disrupt the biofilm inside there. So either a water flosser or perioprotect trays or something like that, and then get them on a medicament in the water pick and make sure they know how to brush their teeth. So my whole thing is I give the patient the toothbrush and I say, show me what you got, get all around in there. And then I watch them and then I say, okay, that's great. Let me just modify it just a little bit. Sometimes that little bit of modifying is a lot of modifying, but the goal is that we have to do full mouth brushing. Bacteria doesn't just live inside the gum, in the gum pockets. It's all over in the mouth. So that patient needs to be doing some full mouth brushing. So from there, I'm going to get her back ASAP. If we have an appointment the next day, then we're going to do back-to-back appointments. In a perfect world, we could do all 4 quadrants in one day, but we know that we typically aren't able to do that when we're utilizing the patient's benefits. And so within 5 days is really the goal, because even if we've cleaned the right side, it's not that bacteria is not just going to say, okay, we can't go over there. We've got to stay over here because that's not cleaned yet. It doesn't work like that. So from there, after we do the second side, we're going to bring her back in 6 weeks, just like that gingivitis case, because again, we're dealing with an infection. And so we want to make sure that we're getting the patient in regularly enough to continue to disrupt that biofilm, decrease it, disorganize it so that the immune system takes back over. I'm going to take a microscope slide. If I have a microscope, I'm going to take new before and after photos. And then I'm going to use that 4921 again, because again, I want to remove that harmful bacteria. I really want to be preventative to decrease the chances that it can build back up again and cause another infection. So my whole thing is focusing on the bacteria, the biofilm, all the things that are more causative for these periodontal infections. And at her before, and so her before and after for the microscope, as you guys can see, she went from lots of volume and motility to very few pathogens floating through her second microscope slide. Most of what you guys see kind of floating through there like a lazy river is healthy cocci, which is exactly what we want. Now for her follow-up appointment, it's the same as gingivitis with the perio maintenance instead. Because she has radiographic bone loss, you know, hopefully in a perfect world, that bone regrows. I mean, they were vertical defects, so we could potentially get some bone regrowth there. We'll have to just wait and see, kind of a thing. But the overall goal, again, with perio maintenance is we're going to continue to disrupt that biofilm as much as possible, because that is actually inclusive of a perio maintenance. So perio maintenance, if you look at the description, even includes some localized scaling and root planing. And so when we look at the definition of scaling and root planing, it's removing that bacteria. So really focusing on that and keeping that patient on a really short recare schedule based on how healthy their mouth is. So when I took a new lab test to ensure that our therapy was successful, it looked really, really good. So overall, the redness of her mouth significantly less, way less red rolled margins, but her overall vestibule was a lot less red. She's still in aligners, went from 6 of the 11 pathogens down to 3. So way, way, way improved. All right, let's look at this young man here. So 28-year-old male. So he reported that it had been at least 3 years since he'd had his teeth clean. He was noticing that his gums weren't feeling very good. They were starting to bleed with brushing, and his girlfriend thought that there must be something wrong with his gums because they didn't look quite right. I would second his girlfriend's opinion. So this is what his full set of x-rays look like. So you guys can see right away, we see big black triangle voids. And so he definitely had more than 4 teeth in each quadrant with radiographic bone loss. So he's lost a significant amount of bone and he's not even 30 years old. When we look at his perio chart, we can see he has plenty of pocketing on there, lots of inflammation, less bleeding points than you guys would probably expect. But because he was so inflamed, we didn't probe so hard. We just decided that we would just, since we had enough data to go ahead and schedule him for full SRP, once we got him numb, then we were going to go ahead and reprobe again to get more accurate numbers, but didn't want to, you know, put all that pain through him. His microscope slide, holy smokes, it kind of looks like electricity. Lots and lots and lots of spirochetes swimming around on his microscope slide, a super, super pathogenic infection. So we see this kind of shape here, this corn cob effect is actually when that bacteria starts to colonize and work together. So very, very serious infection. So he was diagnosed with stage 2, localized stage 3, grade B. So his recipe was precision periodontal therapy 2, and his clinical findings are here. And so we scheduled him right away for 4 quadrants of 4341. But what do I do next? Of course, a lab test, because even though I could see that he had a lot of pathogenic bacteria, I don't know the entire profile. So I need to take a lab test to find out what exactly do you have and quantitatively how much is there. And the best way to do that is a lab test. And so this is where he started out with. He had all but 2 pathogens and they were all almost off the charts, guys. I mean, he had all the bridge species, the early colonizers, those are like the green and the yellow and the orange, and they were all almost 10 to the 7th. I mean, very serious infection for a young man. So this diagnosis appointment looks, as you guys will notice, exactly like the other 2. Full set of x-rays, comprehensive perio exam, photos, microscope, salivary lab test. Getting him back right away for his SRP appointment. Now he is 4341 because he does have more than 4 teeth in every quadrant. So I'm going to be spending that whole time. Now he did have a lot more calculus than those other 2 patients. So this was going to take me longer to scale in root plane and to do that overall process of disrupting the bacteria because he had deeper pockets and he had more debris. But let's remember that calculus does not have to be present in order for a patient to need scaling and root planing. If you're seeing patients that are just bloody prophes over and over or bloody perio maintenances over and over, maybe they had SRP 5, 6, 3 years ago, whatever the case may be, if they're still bleeding, they're not healthy. And it's not because it's their fault. They just came in contact with some bad bugs. Their mouth got sick. Their immune system's not able to take over it. We know that in periodontal infections, bad bugs can outnumber the good bugs by 3 times. So the immune system is completely overwhelmed. So if you have a patient that has diabetes or lupus or psoriasis or some of these other inflammatory conditions, they're going to be even more likely to have a periodontal infection. And they may not heal as fast as some of these patients I'm showing you guys tonight, because these patients that I'm showing you guys tonight, they are younger. They don't have any inflammatory conditions. So they're more of your cut and dry cases. However, we all have patients like these in our practice. I mean, the CDC stated that by age 30, 50% of the population already had bone loss. I mean, that's a lot. In our retirement community, already has 6-7 millimeter pockets, 65% of them. So there's tons and tons of infection, and they all look a little bit different. But what they have in common is the bacteria profile. They have 1, 2, 3, or maybe all 11 pathogens. Maybe their medical history is completely clear, or maybe it's full of stuff. We really have to keep in mind that all of these therapies, we really need to look at their medical history to see, like, okay, is this patient going to have a harder time healing? Do I need to talk to them a little bit more about their medical history? If you have a patient that has psoriasis, they're probably on, and they're on a medication for it, that's also immunosuppressing drug. So it's almost like having a double whammy. So there's a lot of things that we need to consider when it comes to our patients and their overall profile. So back to this young man though. So my SRP was going to be SRP, the right side first, same home care. His baking instructions were no different. Because he had deeper pockets, I told him, like, hey man, you've really got to get on this water pick, like, no slacking off. You got to be with me here. All those bacteria you saw on the microscope are not going to go away on their own. So then we got him back ASAP for the left side, made sure that he was on point with his home care. And then he came back again for his 6-week follow-up. 6-week follow-up, exactly the same as gingivitis, PPT1, PPT2 is obviously, like, here is the same, and so on and so forth. So main thing, looking at the microscope, are we decreasing volume and motility of the overall pathogens? Photography, keep them motivated as well. And then again, I'm using that gingival irrigation per quadrant code because I'm wanting to decrease and disrupt all of that pathogenic harmful bacteria. I don't want it to get a foothold to start to reflourish again. His before and after was so good. So you guys can see left versus right slide, the slide on the right 6 weeks later, he's got some short rods on there, which are considered completely normal when they're not swiggling and wiggling around. So we want low volume, low motility on the microscope. So when it looks boring, that's exactly what we want. Jumping to his 3-month periodontal maintenance appointment. So perio maintenance, if that patient is due for an exam, go ahead and grab an exam. The lab test, we're going to take an after test because we want to make sure that our therapy was successful. And then we're going to double check on home care. So I can't emphasize enough, if your patient's looking really good, make sure they keep doing what they're doing at home. It's so easy for people to look really great at the follow-up appointment 6 weeks later because they're really motivated. You've just talked about everything. It's really fresh in their mind. But then they go out on their own and life happens and we kind of get back into our old habits. And so we just want to make sure that we're keeping them motivated and saying, hey, everything that you're doing is working, keep doing it. Now, if a patient's not looking good and they are doing everything that they're supposed to do, that's when we go back to the drawing board with their medical history, with their home care protocols and the whole thing. So his before and after photo, you guys can see, looks so good. I mean, he started with his gum tissue was about magenta and it looks so pale pink, way, way better. Teeth look whiter. Everything's cleaner. It's so much better. He went from all but 2 pathogens down to 4. Now his FN is still a bit high, so I'm not super comfortable with that bug. But in terms of how much progress he made in only 3 months, this is absolutely remarkable because a lot of patients are not going to have this much bacteria decrease this fast. And so when you see this kind of radical change, you're on the right track. So it's one of those situations where you just keep doing what you're doing. You guys can use these same recipes when it comes to patients that are PPT3, PPT4, your mucositis and your periimplantitis, same kind of thing. We're always dealing with these periodontal pathogens, inflammation, that host immune response. So when we focus on these infections from an infection type of standpoint versus debris, plaque, calculus, it sets a different parameter. So to know if your therapy was successful, did you decrease the pathogen load? Not did you decrease the debris is what we really want to be looking for. The citations with some of our presentations, you guys can find them here. And thank you guys very much. And so with that, I will pivot this back to Dr. Rawling, and then we'll go into Q&A.
All right. And I know that there are so many questions, Tosha. We have been fielding some of those. I'm going to bring up your contact slide because I think there are going to be some folks who are going to want to contact you directly. There are questions about what microscope to use, what do you irrigate with, and so forth. Those, I think, would be good questions. Reach out to Tosha directly. And let's look at some of the questions here. Jen, what do you see? I see that you've been answering some.
Yes, I've been trying to clear through some of them. Some of them are pretty in-depth, which is great. I love that. And yeah. So those would be best for email. So, yeah, when it comes to a microscope question, I led her back to Tosha. Tosha's microscope slides are so good. And she you video them too, right, Tosha? You video those and save them.
I want to point out, too, that your microscope course is still available on demand on our website.
Oh, yeah, it is. Probably for 5 or 6 months at least.
Yes. So go to DLC Academy, go to the on demand, and search for the microscope. The benefits, yes. It is there.
So just the top B, benefits of
our. Yep. There's a question about nutritional counseling, which I think is interesting. In terms of inflammatory response, do you want to make any comments about that one? Do you go through nutritional counseling?
So that is a huge part, because this CE this evening is only an hour. I really couldn't get a ton into that. But in terms of all those ingredients, that would most definitely be part of my home care. And so going over home care, that is, if you have a patient that's a high caries risk or has, if you just know that everything that they're doing at home has to do with a lot of sugar, all bacteria love sugar. Pathogens, cavities, all the things. So yes, nutritional counseling is huge.
So we had a question on the laser. Yeah, if you've got a laser, use it. Pop it in there. Absolutely.
Question about, do you always give recommended antibiotics from salivary testing?
Would you like this or anything?
Oh, you take it.
Okay. So when it comes to systemic antibiotics, it's completely a personal preference. There's so much confusion over systemic antibiotics now that it really depends on that specific patient. And so, there's a lot of antibiotic recommendations that get given on the lab test, but those reports are based on class 3 periodontal disease. No lab test in the world can see your patient's medical history, can see your patient's abilities or lack thereof, all the different things. And so that's why it's so important to do a before and after test so that you know your therapy was successful. If you can after test and you were not successful, maybe you need to go back to the drawing board and talk with a physician. So there's a lot to unpack with that.
And we give a suggested antibiotic. So it's not necessarily a recommendation, but we say, hey, if you've tried everything, you've done everything, laser, all the treatments, and you're not getting success, now would be the time that you could recommend the antibiotics or, recommend those antibiotics that we have suggested. But those antibiotics on the report, they are targeted to the specific bugs present. So they're not just a, hey, one size fits all. It's a target. Yep. And so that's why it comes down to understanding that periodontal disease is an infection. And that's why in my little part there, I had, don't want to treat patients the same no matter how bad it is. And so, thank you for doing that there, Tosha.
There is a lot of questions here. So I'm going to make a recommendation, and a lot of those are very specific, what kind of irrigant you use and so forth. Hopefully you all have downloaded the handouts. You'll have Tosha's information or take a screenshot of it, Tosha and Jen's information. Reach out to them with your questions, and we're going to transition now to a promotional webinar. So you just got the tip of the iceberg tonight. What you want to be able to do is attend the event in April, because then you're going to get all the details and all of the protocols in depth. So, Jen, do you want to go ahead and bring your presentation up?
Yeah, I would love to. Thank you. And of course, it's also a good time because, could tell my part. Okay, here, let me get to my screen.
And I'm going to put a call to action banner at the top of the screen so they can reach out to you directly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so at Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm, we sold out in September. So our first course was in September, and we sold out. We were just, it was so much fun. I mean, believe it or not, talking about bacteria treating periodontal disease can be fun. And we just, Tosha and I, we created Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm because we want to build this community and we want to help dental hygienists. My husband says, do you just love all dental hygienists? Yeah, I do. I do. I really do. And so does Tosha. So anyways, here's a little fun clip. Our next course is April 4th and 6th. We're always going to be in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm in Cookeville, Tennessee. Tosha's in Nashville. Nashville is so fun. So yeah, here's a little clip.
Get you started. Hey y'all, are you ready to recalibrate your gingivitis and periodontal protocols? Join us April 5th and 6th, 2024 in Nashville, Tennessee for Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm. We're going to give you all the latest on oral systemic, go over coding and protocol, give you those verbal skills for patient acceptance. Also, go over the hygiene microscope and bacterial testing. And of course, we're going to have hands-on happy hour. It's Nashville. Come on, y'all. We may have to, you know, let's post that on our Instagram. You want to, yeah. Tosha? Let's post that on our Instagram. My video.
Instagram is at Boots Bugs, the letter N, Biofilm.
Boots Bugs and Biofilm, yeah. And we try to be fun. And also on our Instagram, we really try to educate. So things that you can also pop into your, you know, share to your Instagram for your patients. And so that's what's fun. So one of the things that we have a real strict guideline what we do. So if you want more info on bleeding gum tissues, oral systemic, all those codes, Tosha just touched on a few of the codes tonight. It's a lot. We have a lot of time dedicated for coding and protocols and questions. So we are actually in the trenches with you, trying to get, you know, your protocol set up for you. So that way, when you leave Nashville, Tennessee on Saturday afternoon, that Monday morning, you're ready to roll. We, of course, talk about salivary testing. And my favorite would maybe be the hands-on happy hour, but, you know.
the F in fun. I mean, she makes it super fun. We always joke, I'll make sure you learn something, and she'll make sure that you have fun doing it. But it can be so tricky because so many of us, like I was saying, you know, like we have these great cookie recipes, but then we also have these great frosting recipes and we don't know where to implement them. So it was really important for Jen and I, when we were doing protocols for our Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm course, that we left time to talk to the practices that have a laser. Okay, so when do I use the laser? How do I get reimbursed for it? What are the rules around this? And what are the verbal skills to use it? So there's so many things like that. I mean, some practices have, you know, now it's, you know, ozonated, not only ozonated gas, but there's ozonated water. There's, I mean, a million different medicaments on the market. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of good, bad, and otherwise. It's really difficult to know when to use what. And so we go over all of that. And so some of the other speakers that we have, they're also dental hygienists. And so during the protocol section of day two, after we go over all the coding and everything, we give everyone time to then put their codes together. And then all of us coaches are walking around the room to make sure that when you guys leave, you have refreshed protocols to go back to your office with. If your front office team comes too, they're going to know exactly how to code. How do we get reimbursement for this valuable services that we have? And we want to make sure too, when we're doing coding, that we're using them properly. A lot of times we have the right code, but we don't know what to submit with them. So it's great to have the entire team there, to have the dentist there to understand like how he or she can be the best quarterback for that hygiene department. Because if the full team's not there, then we're leaving just the hygienist to like bring all that information back. And if you guys have ever been to a seminar before, like it can be a lot of great information, but it's hard to regurgitate that to our team.
For sure. Absolutely. And also one of the speakers we're having in April is an orthopedic surgeon. His wife is an MD, and just so lovely. And he's an orthopedic surgeon. And so he's going to give us his take on oral systemic. One of my favorite parts, and Tosha, we didn't talk about this, but one of my favorite parts of Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm is what he's going to talk to us about is you have that patient, let's say, that's going in for a major surgery. We are providing you templates. That way you can give this, and the patient has periodontal disease. That way you can give the information to their physician, whether it be a cardiologist, OBGYN, orthopedic surgeon, templates. That way we can have the same information. We can coordinate together because
language.
Yes, exactly. That way it's in their language and our language. We can say, hey, red flags, we've got your patient and they have heart disease. They've got periodontal disease. We have all this problem happening. And here's the information.
Beautiful shirts. What's our timeline? What's our timeline for these awesome shirts that we got here?
Hang on a second. So if you sign up for Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm, let me get to that, Tosha, here. If you sign up for our next course, April 5th and 6th, are you showing them? I can't even see.
Yes.
Okay. So next week, so if you're watching this recorded, if you sign up, use the Dental CE code. So we provided Dental CE Academy with their own code. You get $100 off per ticket and you get a little sweatshirt. Yeah. So we have the Hank and the Dolly sweatshirts.
I like to name them. It wasn't me.
That's right. So anyways, if you sign up within the next week, December 14th, we'll send you a sweatshirt. Yeah. It's kind of cute. I'm excited for it. So we've had some really good attendees, and they give us amazing reviews. And so folks are coming back, to their offices and really making a change in what they're seeing in their hygiene department. And we're leaving it all out there. I mean, you know, Tosha, I leave it all out there. So here's Tosha and I, if you want to have a direct contact to us, of course, I'm with Microblink DX, scan the QR code. Here's Tosha. This goes to my cell phone. This goes to your website, I believe, right, Tosha?
To my calendar link if people want to.
Your calendar link. Yeah, just text me. I'm all about texting. So we are with this together. And here is the code. So here's the QR code. And the Dental CE 100 is the code for the $100 off per ticket. You go to bootsbugsandbowelfilm.com. So you're invited, y'all. I'm so excited.
I want to remind everybody, Jen, too, that they can tap on that banner at the top of the screen.
Okay.
It will take them right to your website and they can bookmark it on their device, take it back to their practice tomorrow because they may have a few others that they would like to invite.
And also, go ahead. I also want to say, so this is a perio-focused event, but if you bring a new assistant, if you bring your office manager, they will be up to speed. So this is not going to be a course that is too much for them. We have broken this down to where it is for anybody. And that's been our focus, Tosha and I. So what we started with Boost Bugs and Biofilm is we say, you know, that dental office that's in a convenience store that's just or in next to a grocery store, we want to hit to them. We want to hit to the basic. It's for anybody. So it's not super where it's going to be over their heads, I should say, as an office manager or a dental assistant. It's for any office member. And so that's what makes it really fun is to have, you know, different a variety of folks there. Yeah, go ahead. Dr. Rawling, you were going to say something. I think I can switch out and I think you were going to make
I'm here. Yeah, you can leave that slide up if you want. There.
Yeah.
Everybody that registered that is here, they have your presentations in the course folder. So they do have this information. Again, you can go to the URL by tapping on the banner at the top of the screen. You have a review that came in, somebody that was at your presentation in April, Boots, Bugs, and Biofilm. Megan, I can't recommend it enough. Attended in September was one of the best courses I've taken.
Oh, that's sweet.
So sweet.
That's sweet. Yes. I love that. I get so emotional about it because I just want to, like, I mean, you know, Tosha, I'm so dedicated into this periodontal infection. And so we lay it all out there. We really do. And so, and we want to build a community to make a difference. And so, yeah.
Our terms are hard every day. I mean, it's so difficult. Like, we know, like, it's, we've been there. I mean, we're both dental hygienists. So we've been in the trenches with you guys. We know how hard it can be to convert a patient that you've been seeing for 5, 6, 7, 8 years. I mean, I remember one of the practices I worked in, I was replacing a hygienist that had been there for 2 decades or something. And then all of a sudden, you know, I pull up in my perio dedication boots, not really boots. And I'm just like seeing all these patients that are bloody profies going, well, I know you're coming in every 3 months for a profi, but you need something else. And so it can be hard to convert those patients. And we don't want them to think that we've been providing them a disservice. But the way that we can utilize these different verbal skills are super important. When we start talking about periodontal disease as the infection that it actually is, it makes so much more sense. I mean, my tools out of school, my verbal skills were the 1 to 3 millimeter pockets is normal and healthy gums don't bleed. And you have 14 bleeding points and 5, 6 millimeter pockets. And none of those words sounded like infection. And so I just landed on deaf ears and they just said, can I just get my teeth cleaned? And I was like, oh gosh.
You spent 20 minutes.
I needed to pivot. Yeah. And then I'm thinking like, I don't have any time to do this anymore.
Right.
So you're going to learn all of those great valuable tools at Boots and Bugs, because if you have more questions during the breaks, you can just ask us. I mean, we're right there. We want to help. We hold absolutely nothing back. Our number one goal for this course is literally that you can implement, just drag and drop what you learn at the course effectively on Monday. I mean, effectively on Monday. So even if you don't have a microscope, you can still enhance your verbal skills to make a huge impact. I mean, the microscope does make it easy, and obviously I love it, but I didn't always practice with a microscope. So we're providing tools that you don't necessarily need. You know, you don't need all these bells and whistles to make a difference in your patient's life and save lives.
I love it. I'm just excited.
I am too. I can't wait.
Yeah. So we're going to hopefully see y'all.
And if you don't follow our Instagram pages, I'm at tosh.care. Jen's at microblinkdx.
DX.
And then at bootsbugs. And my Instagram page is also just a bunch of education because I'm a nerd.
Yeah.
And again, go to the website and take the microscope class, and Tosha lays it all out for you. So it's a very interesting class, very popular.
And also pathogens and plaque is on there too.
Both of them. Okay. Good, good, good.
So we'll follow up with an email. We'll include those two links to everybody that registered.
Okay. Sounds great.
Awesome.
Any questions about the event? Again, tap on the banner and bookmark it, and you have the information in your course folder. Mm-hmm. I hope to be there. I need to travel, and
get your boots now.
I've got boots. I'm in Scottsdale, so I have boots.
Okay, good. Good. Bring your boots.
Yeah, definitely. Sounds like fun.
Yes. Yes.
We have questions about, will there be other dates, or is this your first date in April?
We're probably going to do once a year in April because we have other commitments to other events. So it's probably the plan is, since our first one was in September, we decided that a spring course would be just better time in Nashville.
Yeah.
And so it's probably going to be annually in the spring in Nashville.
Right. This is our side gig. So, you know, I do my bacterial testing, and Tosh has her clients, coaching clients, and she does daily. And so this is our passion. And so, I doubt we'll do another one in September or in 2024. I don't know if we can swing it. But also the location is hard because it's, you know, downtown Nashville, and Nashville is the hot spot. I mean, it's our location where we have it.
question about, are there more interactive classes like these that you'll do in the future?
Possibly so. In 2024, I have a couple speaking events that I'm doing that will talk about the microscope and the salivary diagnostics. They're not going to be quite as interactive. So the difference with Boots and Bugs is we have the microscope there. We have that hands-on happy hour so people can go over to the PerioProtect booth and check out the trays, come take a microscope slide. We can see what's maybe potentially swimming in their mouth. They can go talk to Jen about doing a lab test. And so they're not as interactive, but more lecture style. And so I don't know of any that are this awesome.
I know, right?
This has been fun. Yeah.
This has been fun.
Yes.
Always fun.
Do you have any other information? Are you going to be recording your April event? So if somebody's not able to attend, where they could watch the recording?
We can't do that.
Okay.
So we can't do that because our thing is we want a feeling and we want to really.
Gotcha.
And we love the Zoom platform. We love that. But I want to hug y'all's necks. I mean, seriously, you know me. So no, we won't ever do it. We won't ever record it. We don't know what we're going to do. Do we, Tosha?
You know, that's true. You never know what the future holds, but it will not be recorded in April. We know that for sure this far, but you never know.
There's so many that went to the banner tonight, so you may have sold out already. We'll find out.
we don't like a lot of, we kind of tap it out to, we don't have a lot of folks there because we do really, like I said, get into the trenches. And so we don't want a big, big, huge event. And so, yeah, you might want to grab your tickets because we did sell out in September. We want to be able to make a difference.
We want to be able to talk to everybody that's there. Like, I mean, if people left and they were like, oh, there wasn't enough time for our protocols and I didn't, you know, I have this piece of technology and I don't even know how to use it or it's collecting dust in my office. Like, well, that's not what we want. Like, we want to make sure everyone leaves there ready to rock and roll, like ready to save lives on Monday morning.
Ready. Exactly. Ready to change this infection.
Great.
Yep. It's got to be done.
Any questions for Jen or Tosha? I can see quite a few people are interested in your event, and that's great. And I'm excited for you too. And lots of thank yous and just excellent information, both of you. Just terrific. Job well done.
Oh,
thank you so much.
Thank you so much. This has been so much fun and such an honor to be invited here. So, I'm excited.
All right. Well, if there aren't any questions, we'll go ahead and we'll close out and get everybody to their quiz. Again, you all have the handouts and you'll have Jen and Tosha's information to reach out to them. And we hope you do. And this will be recorded. So if you have colleagues that will benefit from this presentation, you'll receive an updated email from us. Thank you both so much for being here. Really appreciate it. Excellent information.
Thank y'all so much.
Thank you. So we'll go ahead and we'll close out now. You'll be redirected to the quiz, everyone. And it'll also be sent to you by email. So have a terrific evening and we'll see you soon.
Stay in touch, y'all. Take care.